morning, everyone. It's great to be able to open God's Word this morning. And I was just thinking of what a privilege it is that we have this thing that we call the Bible. It's God's Word. It's God's thoughts. It's God's dreams for us. It's God's wisdom. And we have that incredible resource to take into our own lives and to open up whenever we like. And today we're going to look at a story from the Gospel of Mark. It's probably one of the most preached passages in God's Word. It's a favorite of preachers. It's the story of Jesus who fell asleep during a storm. We're going to look at the account from Mark chapter 4, but before we look at it, I want you to think about this. Whenever we are looking at the Gospel stories, whenever we're looking at the interaction between Jesus and the disciples, we need to remember that these guys were not just companions, these guys were not just Jesus' mates, these guys were disciples. And disciples of Jesus means someone who's being trained, it means one who's learning, it means a trainee, if you like. And so these men were in a training program. When they decided to follow Jesus, when he called them, they didn't understand at that moment. They enrolled in a college. They enrolled in a training course. And so everything that they went into with Jesus, every time they saw him heal someone, every time they saw him show compassion, every time they heard him preach, it was part of their curriculum. It was God-ordained, a purposeful method of training and teaching them what Jesus was like, what God was like, and what following Jesus was meant to look like. So nothing was random. So this particular day, verse 35, tells us that that day when the evening came, Jesus said to his disciples, "Let's go over to the other side." Now, this simply is all about the fact that Jesus' ministry prior to this was pretty much on the western side of the Sea of Galilee. This is a sea in Israel today. It's about 12 miles long, about 6 miles wide in the old money. And on the western coast was where Jesus' ministry was particularly at that time. He'd been preaching, he'd been teaching, he'd been healing people, he'd been thronged with crowds, and he was weary. And I think what this is all about is that he said to the guys, "Let's go over to the eastern side of the lake, less populated, less people, let's have a little bit of downtime." And so leaving the crowd behind, they took him along just as he was in the boat. There are also other boats with him. I'm rather curious about those other boats. We don't know anything about them. I don't know what happened to them in the storm or whether they turned back. Have no idea. But they were in this particular boat. It's an interesting word. It says they took him along, and the verb in the Greek there means not just that Jesus tagged along. It means that they were taking him, if you like, into their care, into their protection. So it was like Jesus was weary. And they took him just as he was, weary and tired. And you can imagine him just clambering into the boat with relief, physically tired after the demands on his life. And then it says that a furious squall came up. Now, Mark writes very immediately. Mark doesn't waste any time. He goes straight into stories. And it's an interesting thought. The Gospel of Mark is widely thought to have the voice of Peter behind it. Mark wasn't a disciple. Mark was younger than those men at the time that Jesus walked on the earth, and he became attached to Peter. Peter actually called him John Mark. He called him my son, just like Paul referred to Timothy in that way. He said, "This guy's my son." They worked together. They shared together, and Peter is thought to have shared his experience with Mark, and Mark penned the words, but it's the voice of Peter and the story of Peter behind. So I'm going to draft Peter into the story today, and I'm going to suggest maybe this boat might have been Peter's boat. Maybe it was Peter and Andrew's, maybe James and John. But whatever it was, this immediately, they were looking forward to this little jaunt across the ocean, and suddenly this massive storm came. It says a furious squall. interesting little word. The word for furious translated there is the word seismos, Greek word, from which we get seismology and seismic upheaval. It was dramatic. Comes about to this day, these storms come out of nowhere on that sea, and many lives have been lost. The storms just come almost from nowhere. Something to do with the geography of where the lake is and the mountains and the difference in pressure, and the wind just seems to come down and throw up these massive waves. This trip wasn't going as they imagined it would, I don't think. I imagine when I'm reading gospel stories, I like to try to put myself there, and I just imagine what it was like on that boat. I kind of imagine that there was a lot of bailing going on. I kind of imagined that there was a lot of yelling and shouting, and I kind of imagined that above the wind, the howling of the wind, above the roar of the wind, and the scream of the wind through the little rigging of the sail, I reckon the voice you'd hear would be Peter's. I reckon it was Peter who was probably yelling out orders. He probably said things like, "Andrew, get over here. Get over here quick." He might have said, I don't know, "Bartholomew and Philip, what are you doing? Get moving with those buckets." I reckon he probably shouted to James or John and said, "Get that jolly sail down and do it quickly." I can imagine his voice just sort of trying to take control. And then I thought, wonder where Thomas was. Maybe Tim or Thomas was hanging for dear life onto the mast. And afraid, terrified for his life. And in the back of the boat, there was Jesus in the stern, sleeping on a cushion. Amazing. In this crazy scene, there's Jesus sleeping through it all. And they were not happy about it. There was nothing respectful about the way they spoke. I think the attitude was possibly this. He's the only one, look at him, he's not doing anything. We're all trying to save ourselves and he's not doing a single thing, he's not helping. And they said to him, as they woke him, "Teacher, don't you care if we drown?" They rebuked him. Matthew's account says, they cried out, "Lord, save us, we're going to drown." Not only do they rebuke him, they accuse Jesus of not caring about their welfare. Nothing could be further from the truth, could it? And we'll talk about that later. Just let me ask this question. Was their concern warranted? Were they overreacting? On one level, not at all. At least four of those guys were fishermen. This was their workplace. This was the sea on which they made their living. They were familiar with the strange things it did. And they knew from experience that on the face of it, this boat was sinking. They knew that everything was saying, we can't keep up. We're not making any headway. The waves are just pouring in. The sea is just rising. They were drenched. What did Jesus do? He got up and he rebuked the wind and he said to the waves, "Quiet, be still." And the wind died down and it was completely calm. Wonderful word with the word quiet there is the word for muzzle. And if you were reading the Greek text, if we could do that, it would say something like this. Jesus was saying in the tense he used, "Be muzzled, wind, and stay muzzled." Be muzzled, be quiet, and stay that way. You know, amazing, amazing. Right then, the wind stopped. That's a miracle. The wind that was causing the waves stopped. But there's more of a miracle here. Immediately, the sea was calm. If you know anything about the ocean, when there's been a great swell, we have a strong sea, even on our coast here, it'll take several days for it to just settle back down again, even though the danger's gone and the wind that's driving it has lulled right away. It's a miracle. Suddenly, from this raging tempest and this screaming wind noise, there was nothing but silence. Right then, creation heard the Creator speak. Right then, the wind and the waves heard the voice of their Master, the one that created them, speak to them and command them to be quiet. He said to his disciples, "Why are you so afraid? Do you still have no faith?" Oh boy. How many of you know the voice of the Lord's powerful? Wonderful psalm that I love very much. I think it's Psalm 29, and it says, "The voice of the Lord is powerful. The voice of the Lord is majestic. The voice of the Lord is over the waters. The God of glory thunders over the mighty waters." And that's what happened right here. And these disciples saw that. And Jesus challenged them in that moment. And he said, what is this with your fear? Why are you afraid? Might read the next verse, I think, and we'll come back. They were terrified and asked each other, "Who is this? Who is this? Even the wind and the waves obey him." Do you know, it's not unusual for us, I think, when we're reading stories like this and we hear those words of Jesus, "How is it that you're afraid? Where is your face? How is it that you have little faith right now in this situation? What's going on with you guys?" It's not unusual when we read that to feel Jesus was perhaps being a tad hard, that he was a little bit unfair, that in view of the fact that we've already said these guys knew this territory, these men knew the danger they were in, they knew this situation was perilous. I was thinking about it. As a community of fishermen on the Sea of Galilee, I would think it was highly likely that Peter and James and John and Andrew knew other fishermen who had drowned in just such a storm. They probably helped along with others in their community to care for the widows and children of just such men just like them. So was their fear unrealistic? No, in one sense it was not. Their alarm and panic was kind of justified. And yet Jesus did rebuke them, and he questioned their lack of faith. So I want to say today and ask this question, was that warranted or not? So we come back and we recall what we started out saying was that these disciples, this was not just a random event. This was an orchestrated event by the King of Kings, who knows everything before it ever happens. He walked with them into this storm. He went with them into the storm, and it was part of their training. He set it up deliberately. I absolutely believe that. I think, you see, when you understand that they had this time with Jesus, they'd sat there where he talked about the Father's care for even the least of these. When he told them that even the very hairs on your head are numbered, that not one tiny sparrow falls to the ground but the Father doesn't know, and that you are so much more valuable than that. They'd heard him preach about faith. They'd heard them preach about the Word of God. And Jesus had an expectation that faith would have grown in their hearts as they heard the Word, because faith comes from the hearing of God's Word. It's intended to produce faith. They had private chats with him. They had private tutorials. They could ask questions. They had things doubly explained. They shared his life. They saw his walk, and so Jesus challenged their faith. Why? On what basis? Probably three reasons. I think that there's probably more, but let's have a look at them. First of all, Jesus had told them what their destination was. Very first verse that we read showed us this. "That day when evening was come, Jesus said to them, 'Let us go over to the other side.'" I'm sure many of you will have heard this been spoken about before, but it's really powerful. Jesus did not say, "Let us go over and face a storm and go to the bottom of the sea." Jesus did not say, "Let's just go for a jaunt." He said, "Let's go to the other side." He had declared their destination at the outset. And when God speaks, he takes you there. When God gives you a promise, he takes you there. And he had said, you're going to the other side. You're not going to Davy Jones' locker. You are not going to the bottom of the ocean. And he had expected that they would believe what he said. I think sometimes we tame God down and we think he's just like us, but he's not. He expects that he knows the power of his word and when we put our faith in what he said. And he expects us to take that on board and to live like we actually believe that, even though we feel natural fear. Second thing is that Jesus was in the boat with them. Statement of the obvious, Pam, but this is it. Who was in the boat with them? Yes, there was a storm. Yes, there was water in the boat. Yes, they were sinking, but Jesus was in the boat. The one who made the sea was in the boat. Not just the one who walked on water, the one who made the sea, the one who was Lord over everything, the one who holds this whole planet together by the word of his power, Almighty God. And you know, they'd seen Jesus do amazing things already. They'd seen him heal awful diseases, deliver people that were oppressed, preach and teach with authority that was amazing. But somehow they hadn't worked out that he was Lord over everything. He is Lord over every situation. They hadn't realized the power of his presence. They hadn't understood the power of the presence of God with them. God with us is Jesus' name. Emmanuel, God with us. God with us. Jesus, the Lord of glory, was in the boat with them. Amazing. Amazing. And another reason, I think, was that here was Jesus visibly at rest in the storm. Now, they weren't happy about it. As I said, they probably were a bit cheesed off that he wasn't contributing to the rescue effort. But here was Jesus visibly at peace, undisturbed by the howling wind, sleeping peacefully when the boat, this little craft, is pitching and tossing violently. And he would have been drenched with wind. That, you know, when it says the waves were coming into the boat, the Greek says that the waves were throwing themselves into the boat. It was quite an amazing situation. They were completely in trouble. And here is Jesus with all this noise and all their shouting, and he's asleep. How could he sleep? I think there's a few reasons. He could sleep because he knew his mission wasn't finished. He could sleep because he knew that he was safe in his Father's care. He could sleep because he was completely in the will of God, and therefore he was safe and secure in his care. The wonderful promise that Jesus clearly knew, in peace I will lay down and sleep, for you alone, O Lord, will keep me safe. Isn't that a beautiful promise? It's a wonderful promise, the nearness of Jesus. The reason we can lie down and sleep in peace when things aren't going right is because Jesus is there. Jesus is there. So how does this story apply to our lives? Well, just like the disciples, when I gave my life to Jesus, I enrolled in a school. I didn't know I did, but I put myself under his tutelage. I put myself in the hands of the great teacher. And he's shaping, wanting to shape and train us and train our lives. And as part of that, he's going to lead me too. And he's going to lead you too through all kinds of situations. Some that I love, some I thrive in, some I enjoy. And some that are challenging. He does not promise us a trouble-free journey, but he does promise to take us to the destination. He is in the boat of our life with us. You know, over and over and over in God's word, he reminds us that we don't have to fear because he is with us. I think we all love Psalm 23, and is that beautiful verse in Psalm 23, even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. That amazing psalm starts out so beautifully. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not be in want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. My cup overflows. Beautiful words. Idyllic. And then suddenly the transition to, even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, in the good times, in the sunshine, in the dark, when life is flowing, when death seems imminent, his presence is just as real. Even though I walk through the storm, the valley of the shadow of death, I don't need to fear. On the basis of what? On the basis of the fact that you are with me. There's a lot of things we face that are uncomfortable. You know, some are even deeply painful. But the Father's promise is that he'll be with us. He will sustain us. He will bring us through. He is in the boat. The situation those men faced that evening was real. So when we face tough times as Christians, we're not meant to get into denial and pretend that we're not in tough times. When we're unwell, we're not meant to pretend we're not well, that we're well. We call it as it is, but we are trusting God, you know. And the situation they were in was absolutely real. The wind was hurricane force. The waves were huge. The boat was filling. They were soaking wet. And so in some of life's storms, we could very well do with a wetsuit. But he tells us something. The promise of God is very simply put like this, that we won't need a snorkel. That might seem a strange thing to say, but I've had times when I would have liked a wetsuit. You go through life and your feet get wet and the cold creeps up your legs and you know that you're in a difficult time. But God's promise is, I will be with you. I will bring you through. You will not sink. You will not go under. Reason? I'm in the boat with you. I'm in this thing with you. So the scripture says to us this amazing passage, Isaiah 43, what a blessing this has been to me in my life. Do not be afraid, for I have ransomed you. I have called you by name. You belong to me. You're mine. So when you do go through deep waters, wouldn't it be good if it said this, you will never go through deep waters. You will never go through rivers of difficulty, but it says when you do go through them, I will be with you. And you contemplate that I, the God of heaven, is with me. When you go through rivers of difficulty, you will not drown. When you walk through the fire of oppression, you will not be burned up. The flames will not consume you. Why? For I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Saviour, your Deliverer. Isn't that amazing? Amazing. I am the Lord your God. Why should you be afraid? Can you see that? You might need a wetsuit. You might need a wetsuit, but you don't need to get your mask and snorkel on, for he is with you. There's another wonderful passage. I just want to let this speak to your heart. The floods have risen up, O Lord. The floods have roared like thunder. The floods have lifted up their pounding waves. Listen to this, but mightier than the violent raging of the seas, mightier than the breakers on the shore, the Lord above is mightier than these. Amazing. Flood rises. Flood roars. And don't circumstances come. Even this one we're all in together now, this COVID situation, none of us expected this. There's so much uncertainty around. So much, just churning of feelings and wondering and trying to plan and realizing you can't. And this insecure sense could just grip you if you allowed it. But God's here. God's here. It's not out of control. God is here. And you know, sometimes the floods do roar like thunder. Circumstances can roar. I've had times in my life when the things that are going on feel like their voice is so loud that they're drowning out everything good, everything peaceful. But the truth is, Jesus is the one who knows how to calm every storm. Jesus is the one who can speak to the wind and the waves of doubt and fear in my life and calm them down. And by the way, he's given us authority to do just the same thing. When he spoke to the wind and the waves, it says he rebuked the wind. The wind was the cause of the waves. And sometimes in our life, the enemy is just trying to disturb us with fear, and we need to rebuke him. So, devil, you're a liar. I can know the peace of God in my life, so I speak peace to myself in the name of Jesus. I speak peace to the waves in my life. So Jesus rebuked the wind, and then he spoke peace to the waves. And we can do that in our own life. You know, what was Jesus looking for from those guys in that boat that night? I think, simply put, he was looking for them to trust him. You know, they did the right thing waking him up, but they hadn't cried out in faith. They didn't cry out in faith. I read a wonderful quote from Jamison, Fawcett and Brown commentary. There is a natural apprehension under danger, but there was unbelief in their fear. And there is. There's a natural apprehension that we can fear, that we can feel, but still we step into the peace of God. Still we step into the fact that God is here. So when they accused him of not caring, of course he did. And so I just want to ask you today, as I have asked myself this week again, what's the Lord looking for from me in life situations? Whether some of you be facing financial situation, some of you wondering how to plan your future, some of you feel like life's on hold, some may be facing health challenges. What is God looking for? He's saying, Pam, do you really trust me? Do you really grasp the fact that I am always with you? I think you might say to me, do you really believe? Do you really believe me when I say to you, I will never leave you. I will never, ever forsake you. I'll never let you down. That night, those guys saw another side of Jesus. It's interesting. They were afraid clearly for their lives, with some reason. But suddenly when they saw Jesus, saw what had happened when he spoke to the waves, when he completely interrupted and halted that storm, and the tempest just died in a moment. They saw his power and his might and his authority like they'd never seen it before. It's called the fear of the Lord. It says they were terrified. I know that sounds strange to our ears, but this is another kind of fear. There's a natural fear, and then there's a fear, the fear of God, which is a reverence and an awareness of God's awesome holiness and God's awesome power. That's the fear of God. And they were gripped with the fear of God. Do you know, I was thinking, I think when we truly fear God in that way, in the sense that we know he's that great, we know he is awesome in power, that everything is at the word of his command, I think those other fears are dispelled when we realize the power of his presence. That kind of God is with me. Not just my loving Heavenly Father, but the God of heaven and earth, who's got all things in his hands. We will know peace in the storms. We will know peace in the storm when we grasp the fact that he is in the boat, the power of his presence. Oh, that phrase ministers to my heart always, just to remember and remind myself that I walk every day with the living Jesus in my life. What a privilege that is. Can I pray with you today? Father, I ask right now that in every home, for all of us wherever we might be right now, and whatever is facing us in our individual lives, I pray that this word, something in this word, and this graphic story, a true story from your word, would just find root in our heart and grow up and create a peace in our heart and a reality that Jesus is here. Jesus is here. I'm not alone. And he's got a plan. He's got a roadmap for my future. Just because I can't see it doesn't mean it's not there. Father, our lives are in your hand. And so we literally right now just say, Lord, here's my life. Here's my family. Thank you that it's in your hands. I commit my way unto you. Thank you, Father, that you will lead us and bring us through. In the mighty name of Jesus, we thank you. Amen. Amen. God bless you, everyone.
Wow, what an incredible message. Thank you so much for that. I just love that thought that God is never going to let you drown. And if you're not a follower of Jesus and you feel like you're drowning today, let me tell you that God will never let you drown. If you will just place your faith and place your trust and you'll wait upon him, he will not let you sink. You may need a wetsuit, you may be engulfed with trouble, but you are never going to need a snorkel. He will not let you drown. And so I would challenge you again, as Mum just did, what is the response that Jesus is requiring from you today? And for some of you, that may just be to put your faith and your weight again in Jesus, as a follower of Jesus, just to be like, oh God, I know that my trust is in you. If you're not a follower of Jesus, it may be to do that for the very first time. And if you're watching this live, there's a link in the chat where you can find out more about what it means to follow Jesus. And we would love to help you along that journey.